rounded with a sleep. I mean, the idea that our life is like a dream. I suppose so, yes. I mean, actually, I think it's the other way around. I think that when we die, or before we're born, it's probably more like a dream, and that it's as if our lives are rounded with a dream. And of course, dreams are part of sleep, so that still fits with what Shakespeare says.
Dream before, dream after, what in between?
Well, waking life with more dreams and fantasies as well. But I think that the dream... Well, I suppose it depends what you mean by dream, but dream is entering into a realm of possibility, of fantasy, of imagination. And there's a sense in which all our lives are an interface between that and the life of embodied existence in the physical world. And I suppose part of the business of science is to explore that interface, because you could say scientific theories come from the dream realm. In fact, some of them come to people in dreams. But then there are many theories. When you test them against reality, you have to do experiments. And experiments are not quite so much like dreams. They're more like oracles. And I think the experimental method is best seen as a modern form of divination. You know, in the Roman times, people cut open animals and examined their entrails. Nowadays, scientists cut open animals and examine the physiology or whatever. You do an experiment, you look at some feature of the world, and you ask for an answer. This is just what diviners did and what the purpose of oracles was. So I think that the experiment serves the role of the oracle, and somehow these experiments modulate our scientific dreams, at any rate. They're subject to some kind of check, whereas the ordinary idea of a dream is that it's free, independent, and has nothing much to do except with one's memories and possibly one's future, one's desires, but is somehow unlimited by reality. Well, science is limited by reality through the experimental method.
What did they say about Voltaire? If Voltaire had not existed, somebody would have to have invented him. I think maybe the same is true of Sheldrake. I think there's a niche in our culture for Rupert Sheldrake. Extremely clever, I think completely wrong, but in such an ingenious way that it's fun to think about trying to prove what's wrong with it.
I don't know his work. Rupert?
Rupert Sheldrake. He's from the UK, a biologist. The presence of the past, a new science of life. He wrote, you don't know him.
I love him as a human being. But he has a biological theory that I'm just convinced is close to totally wrong. But he's thought it through. He understands the philosophical basis of it, where friendly adversaries. I once gave him a whole lecture of mine to express his views to my class. It was one of the most interesting classes we ever had, but I don't think he's right.
Rupert Sheldrake.
And so there again, I plead total ignorance.
He is the one with the holistic approach of reality, so to say.
Yes, no, well, I hate isms of any kind.
The things I've heard people report of his general position are things that I don't find congenial, but I don't know them well enough to be able to say why I don't find them congenial. I shall find out, I've no doubt. He's not, you know, one has to make certain investment choices, and his was one of the, you know, he's one of the people who I've never just invested the time in.
I was on the family willow farm. My grandmother's family grew willow trees for making baskets. And I was staying at the family farmhouse, and I was outside with an uncle. And I saw a row of willow trees with rusty wire hanging between them. So I said to my uncle, why is that rusty wire hanging between those trees? And he said, well, we made a fence out of willow stakes, and the fence came to life. And I looked, and of course then I could see that each of these was like, you could see how each had been a fence post, and the these wooden posts had formed shoots and roots, and it wasn't a fence anymore, it was a row of living trees. And this made, you know, really a tremendous impression on them, because this sense of the dead things coming to life in such a vivid way that you could directly see, the whole thing lasting only maybe 10, 20, 50 seconds. I don't know how long this incident lasted. But when I remembered it, this particularly vivid incident, I then saw, both to my surprise and delight, and also to some extent horror, that in this childhood memory was summarized much of my subsequent scientific career. I spent years working on plant development, on the behavior of isolated stem cuttings, and a lot of what I did subsequently was foreshadowed in this particular memory.
Ooit gefantaseerd, als kind, dat je onzichtbaar was en dat je dus alles van de wereld te weten kon komen en de wereld onmerkbaar kon veranderen? Nee, zegt Sheldrake. Dat je andermans gedachten kon lezen? Nee, zegt Sheldrake. Dat ons heelal slechts één enkel atoom was, in het oog van iemand in weer een heel ander universum, zoals de atomen in ons heelal op hun beurt complete zonnestelsels herbergden.
I did, yes, I did actually. I don't know how many people have this, but I vividly remember when I was a child, maybe 6 years old, I don't know my age, I was lying in bed, it was in the summer, in my bedroom, and I saw the dust in the sunlight as it came through the window, you know, when you watch dust particles move. And I was watching these dust particles. And then the idea came to me quite spontaneously that each of those particles might be a whole world like our world. And in those worlds, there might be people lying in bedrooms looking at dust particles, and each of those would be a world. And so this idea of infinite, like Chinese boxes, worlds within worlds, stretching infinitely in both directions, large and small, suddenly struck me. I mean, this was probably the biggest idea I'd had in my life by that time. It's suddenly an idea of such immensity, and it was quite out of keeping with all the other things I thought about, but suddenly this idea took hold of me, and I was very fascinated by it.
And now, because you were not unique, I had the same fascination, so I'm sorry, but this picture of universes within universes, like Chinese boxes, is there any development, or is this, the amazement the same and the conclusion the same when you're grown up?
Well, I wouldn't put it in quite the same way, but what I would say is that the...
But essentially?
Essentially, the since I believe in that the right approach to nature for science and in general is the holistic approach, is to see that everything is nested within something else, like the Earth is a unit, but the Earth is within the solar system. The solar system is a unit, but that's within the galaxy, and the galaxy is a unit, but it's within a cluster of galaxies. And then all these are together within the whole universe, which is the ultimate physical unit. And then if we come from the Earth, we have ecosystems that are units, and then societies, and then within those, organisms that are units, and within them, organs, and within those tissues, and within those cells, and within those molecules, and within those atoms, and then subatomic particles, and then complexes of subatomic particles going, disappearing into the realm of the very small, until they disappear from our ability to detect them, because the smaller they get, the bigger the apparatus you need to find them. And the ultimate limit is not set by nature herself, but rather by the willingness of the US Congress to go on funding ever larger accelerators. So at least from the small to the large, I would see that indeed as the structure of the universe, in this sense that at every level there's a wholeness which contains parts which are themselves wholes which contain parts, is, I would say, the very basis of the holistic worldview and the view of nature, which is the background to all my own scientific thinkings.
Why is the grass green? Why does the moon have phases? Why is the sky blue?
Oh, yes.
Children's questions. Are your children asking you the same questions you asked your father?
Well, I can't remember what I asked my father, but I imagine they must be the same kind of questions. I mean, these are very fundamental questions. And my children are very fascinated by death, for example. They ask about what happens when you die. Why do things die? They're very interested by stories of witches and giants that eat up children. They're very concerned with the whole question of being eaten and eating and killing and dying. These preoccupy them tremendously. All the stories they like have to involve elements of wicked witches or wicked giants.
Why is that?
Who eat little children. I don't know. I think children, the whole question of eating and the nature of eating and the nature of death and destruction and killing fascinates them. Partly because we don't eat meat, you see, so they think about animals and killing animals, and why do people kill animals, and why do animals kill other animals?
What do you say in reply?
Well, I explain that in nature, things have to eat something, and animals either eat other animals or they eat plants, and even if you eat plants, you kill them, but there's all this eating and killing going on as part of the structure of nature. But if you look at the fairy tales that young children read, Grimm's fairy tales, for example, it's amazing how many of them involve stories of killing, eating, or life-threatening situations of various kinds. And then it became clear to me why young children may be so obsessed with this, because I don't know about Holland, but in England, a very common phrase, we have our two-year-old, very often, adults will come and they'll pick him up and they say, "You're so gorgeous, I could eat you up." Now, what must a two-year-old child think when an adult picks him up and smiles and says, "You're so gorgeous, I could eat you up," especially when he hears stories about wicked witches and giants that eat little children every day? I mean, it must be very confusing, and I don't know why adults say it, but this is a big issue for young children. I think there's an urge to reproduce and survive inherent in organisms. It's obvious, it's a basic truth of life. And I suppose the real question is there more to life than that? I mean, I think the problem with usual theories of purpose in evolution is most people who think there's a purpose in evolution think that the purpose is to produce modern scientists or modern Europeans or something like that. And I personally find it hard to believe that the purpose of the entire cosmos culminates in President Bush or something like that. I just don't find it a very plausible theory. So ones that are too human-centered seem to me inadequate theories of the purpose of evolution. So the trouble is, on the one hand, theories of cosmic purpose usually end up with what seems to me a rather banal sense of that purpose, namely the appearance of human beings on one small planet in a vast cosmos. And so I find a problem in saying, well, if there is a purpose, well, what is it? Perhaps the purpose is greater complexity, consciousness, self-consciousness. I mean, one could give answers like that. The strength of the Darwinian view seems to me that it emphasizes the importance of diversity. And it's very difficult to see, if you have a purposive view of evolution, why it should require so much diversity, unless diversity is in itself a purpose.
Yes.
You see, if we think the purpose of evolution is the evolution of human consciousness or the evolution of self-reflective intelligence or something like that, then why do we need 5 million species of beetles and butterflies in the Amazon alone? I mean, what is the purpose of this incredible diversity of life that we find here on Earth? Mm. Not just now, but in the past.
Darwin wrote once in a letter, what a book a devil's chaplain might write on the clumsy, wasteful, blundering, low, and horribly cruel works of nature. Talking about purpose.
Yes, well, Darwin was very keen to expel purpose from nature because he became increasingly atheistic and he wanted to keep God out of it. Yes. So he had a hidden agenda, which was the expulsion of God from nature. He started by reacting against the theology of Paley, the blind watchmaker, well, the watchmaker God of Paley, that Richard Dawkins has described as the blind watchmaker. He was reacting against a theological view that treated animals and plants as machines made by an engineering God. This image of God as a kind of mechanical engineer was what Darwin rejected. And in rejecting this image of God, he wanted to reject purpose from nature and any sense of sudden jumps or any surprising creativity in nature. Well, he didn't know any better than anyone else does about what's really going on, but he had a hidden theological motive for saying what he did. And I think that we can see in the world what we want to see. One of the features of the universe is that it's reflexive. If we think everything in the universe is organized in polarities, we see polarity wherever we look. If we think it's all organized in threes, we see patterns of threes and trinities wherever we look, or fours. And if we want to see destruction, waste, and cruelty everywhere we look, we can see it in the human world and in the biological world. If we want to see cooperation, symbiosis, and mutual help, then again, we can see it wherever we look in the human realm and in the natural realm as well. And I think that Darwin particularly emphasized the destructive aspects of nature, partly because of personal psychological motives and partly because he made destruction the primary creative power.
How deep-rooted is this myth of striving upwards evolution leading towards man and consciousness? Because if I talk to people and I say, what is Darwinism all about? They say, survival of the best. Finally, human beings are the best on top of the ladder. How deep-rooted is this myth of straight-jacket linear progress?
Oh, I think it's terribly deep-rooted because I think the evolutionary idea in biology started from the evolutionary idea in human affairs. The idea of human progress came first, then it was generalized to biology, and then now to the cosmos. But the idea of human progress, which was part of the ideology of the late 18th century, the Enlightenment, the rationalists, was the idea that through the reason, particularly through scientific reason, modern man has risen above the superstitions of the Middle Ages, the Catholic religion, or indeed any religion, and that in turn has risen above the primitive, ignorant superstition of animistic tribes and societies, barbaric savages. And so this idea of human progress culminating in the 18th century gentleman as the ultimate peak of the human development from savagery or barbarism to civilization, and then from civilization to scientific civilization, and the Enlightenment intellectual being the peak of the whole thing. This is so deeply built into the ideology of intellectuals and of the whole Enlightenment and rationalist view.
Even now and again even and
now,
again.
Even now. Yes, because it's what sustains the Enlightenment view that our civilization is superior to the civilization of our grandfathers and our great-grandfathers, and certainly to that of the Middle Ages, and also to that of all other tribes around the world who have to be educated into our way of seeing things because our way is the best. So this is still the standard ideology of the whole mainstream of Western thought. And given the fact that that kind of ideology came first, and then the evolutionary picture of life was added on, so you then saw the progression from the primeval slime as animals then crawled out onto land, and then monkeys swung in trees, and finally it ends up with civilized man, and nowadays, of course, people would say civilized woman as well. This evolutionary progression as seen in it is so deep-rooted in our ideology that it's extraordinarily difficult.
How dangerous is it?
Well, I don't think it's... it depends how you take it. If you take it that our civilization has the right to exterminate all other cultures, not through force any longer, because we think of ourselves as civilized, but by exporting our technological industrial system, our educational system, and our scientific worldview, which we've now done to the rest of the world. I mean, as soon as anyone discovers a backward tribe living anywhere, if there are any left, then they'll want to move in, build roads, have development agencies, UNESCO will set up schools and so on, so they can be turned into people just like everyone else, and within 10 years they'll have television. That's what's happening in the world today, and it shows an extraordinary intellectual and cultural imperialism on the part of the technological advanced societies. The very word advanced or developed, you see, implies that they're higher and better. And when extrapolated to the whole of nature, it means we're the most evolved things in nature because we're more conscious, more purposive, and so on. And in fact, all other animals and plants are supposed to be totally unconscious or only the most rudimentary kind of awareness. Only we have this magical self-reflective consciousness. And then, if that's taken to give us the right to exploit the rest of nature, use it as we like, we then have the roots of the ecological crisis. So I would say that this particular way of thinking is extremely deep-seated. It underlies the thinking of a great many evolutionary theorists, including Darwin, and is one of the things that's caused the great problems of the modern world.
Wat er ook gebeurt tijdens de samenkomst, de ruzie tussen Sheldrake en Dennett is een gegeven. Tussen hen beiden lijkt geen enkele verzoening mogelijk.
I think Dennett's approach is it shares this mechanistic obsession of the idea of the machine as the central paradigm. You see, I think the problem of the last 300 years of mechanistic science has been to assume that the only valid form of thinking about nature is to use machine metaphors. Previously, you see, people had always used organic metaphors. You used the metaphor of organisms, of animals, of plants, of trees, of people, of families. These are the kinds of metaphor that permeate all traditional thinking. They're the stuff of myth and of poetry. Since the 17th century, there's been an attempt to substitute in rational scientific thinking a single source of metaphor, namely man-made machinery, as the only valid source of thinking about nature. I think it's an intensely anthropocentric thing to do. It takes a particular one aspect of human activity, a very recent one also, and projects this human obsession with machinery onto the whole of nature. So then the question is, are we ourselves machines, and that people were machines, but with this rational mind, a God-given rational mind somewhere inside the head, that controlled the machinery. Well, this Cartesian dualism has been the dominant model in the West ever since the 17th century. And the main way that people try to deal with it is by denying that there is anything autonomous about the rational mind. The materialist wants to say, well, we're machines just like everything else in nature. And so then you have to explain the thinking conscious mind. So then you have to say, well, we're intelligent thinking conscious machines. But there aren't any intelligent thinking conscious machines. So
Not yet, then
you have to say, well, then we'll invent them just to prove that we're intelligent thinking conscious machines. And so this is the striving for artificial intelligence, to make intelligent thinking conscious machines, the ultimate purpose of which is to prove that we're nothing but machines. Well, since machines are made by people in the first place, it seems to me such a futile, and it's like a dog chasing its tail. It seems to me an entirely futile exercise, and I can't get very engaged with this entire quest to try and prove through enormous intellectual convolutions, through frightfully clever arguments, that we're nothing but machines by imagining that our brains are some kind of self-programming computer of a type that doesn't actually exist, but of which we're promised there will be examples at some time in the future. The problem you see with materialists is that we're not thinking machines, and there are no thinking machines. And so they have to keep pretending that they will exist. They can have computers, can play chess and so on. At some time in the future, there will be this amazing thinking machine.
It's fully conscious, like we are.
Well, then, of course, the question is, how do we decide whether it's fully conscious or not? And this, of course, gives philosophers... you can write many tons of books on this subject because it's hard to prove that even another person is conscious, let alone a machine. So there's so many philosophical problems here. There's enough mileage in this for philosophers to go on for centuries more arguing about these particular questions. But I just don't think it's a very fruitful or fertile debate. And I think the problem is, you see, that if you say that we're like computers, we're self-programming computers, you've still got the bit that does the programming. There's the computer model is inherently dualistic. The software is like the mind, the hardware is like the brain or the body. And it keeps landing one back in the same old Cartesian dualism in one way or another. I don't see that it takes us beyond it. And of course, the idea of thinking of the brain as a computer is just a way of trying to update the machine metaphor to use the latest technology.
Well, Dennett wrote, for instance, the idea that the self or the soul is really just an abstraction strikes many people as simply as a simple and negative idea, a denial rather than anything positive. But in fact, it has a lot going for it, including a somewhat more robustly conceived version of potential immortality than anything to be found in the traditional ideas of the soul. Abstractions.
Well, curiously enough, a lot of this computer thinking was started by Alan Turing, the British mathematician during the war. He began to develop these ideas about computing systems, and he laid the foundations of modern computing theory. Now, it's very interesting that Turing was motivated by a desire to prove the immortality of the soul. Turing was homosexual. His dearest friend, when he was at school, died at the age of about 18. And he was obsessed with in what sense his friend could be said to survive the death of the body. And he came to the idea that if the self was nothing but a kind of logical structure of abstractions, of the kind that you can put as a program in a computer, then you can take this program from one computer to another, and this you can have a kind of immortality of this system of abstractions that's independent of the physical base in which it's realized in the form of computers. So there's a sense in which this dualism of body and soul, or program and machine, which is present in the computer metaphor, and which Dennett may be alluding to, was built in right at the very beginning by Alan Turing, and one could even say that this was part of his motivation for doing it. It was to find a way of proving a kind of immortality without having God or anything to do with traditional religion. It was to find a kind of abstract mathematical basis for a sort of abstract immortality.
Ik leg Sheldrake opnieuw de woorden voor van Stephen Jay Gould. Gould, die schrijft dat de natuur non-moreel is. Dat de natuur ons geen enkel ethisch houvast kan bieden. Als we prijs stellen op moraliteit, kunnen we haar alleen binnen onszelf vinden.
Well, I haven't spent a lot of time thinking about questions of morality. Okay. And so it's not.
But you're dealing with it every day.
Yes.
I'm making everyday choices about morality.
Oh yes, I mean I'm interested in the whole subject, but I mean I haven't spent a lot of time thinking about how it relates to the uniquely human. You see, the thing is, a lot of secular humanists are very much into this speciesist thing. They have to prove that human beings are radically different from everything else in nature, and the usual things they use are consciousness and morality. These are all tool making,
free will,
machine making. Well, these are the standard arguments, and they're used, of course, to justify the fact that it's wrong to kill people, but it's all right to kill cows to make hamburgers, or battery chickens to have Kentucky fried chicken. You've got to have some kind of justification for the way we behave. So I would say, though, that if you look at the natural world, that most of the things we think of as moral features are things that we can find pre-shadowed in many ways in the natural world. For example, parental care and affection, which are a basic aspect of responsibility. Moral responsibility towards children is a key part of all human societies. And when you look at the behavior of birds looking after their young and animals in general, and the way they care for their young and raise them, you could say that here we see maybe an unconscious or instinctive, but we certainly see the principles of parental care and responsibility at work.
But when you're looking at caterpillars eating their own parents, then you can say, well, here we are back again with Darwin and his cruel, horribly cruel world.
Well,
it's where you're looking at.
Well, I mean, I don't know whether more caterpillars eat their parents than people kill other people. I mean, if you look at human wars, it's not a very impressive record for human beings being distinctly better than other animals in terms of not killing each other. In fact, I'd say we're probably worse than most in terms of our record in killing members of our own species. I think the problem, you see, is to take the moral as the distinctively human, is to take a theoretical argument, it's to fall into a kind of narcissism where we look at an idealized reflection of ourselves. If you look at the reality of human behavior, then you find brutal massacre and killing of members of our own species is part of what people have done for a long time, and the so-called modern civilized world has done more of it than most. And the recent Iraq war showed, you know, it was considered perfectly all right to massacre with weapons of mass destruction tens of thousands of retreating soldiers, things that in the past would have been considered inconceivably brutal are now considered perfectly normal. And so There's no growth of morality, it seems to me, with the advance of technological civilization. And if you look at the actual practice of human beings, and you look at, do human beings on average kill each other more or less than the members of other species? The answer is, I think they kill each other more than the members of most other species do.
Look, for instance, in the wolves.
Yes, and look at any. It's very rare to find animals killing other members of their own species. But it's quite common to find human beings doing it, and modern civilized societies like our own are still in Britain, still building weapons of mass destruction. Enormous increase going on at present in British nuclear armaments. Why? I mean, the capacity to destroy hundreds of millions of people, considered perfectly normal. In fact, it's being expanded. So, I find the morality argument as a kind of species badge of honor, not a very strong one. I mean, it's certainly the case that human beings...
But morality would make us unique.
Well, the trouble is that morality, as conceived by Enlightenment philosophers, seems to me a kind of abstraction. If you look at morality as practiced in traditional societies, it's not usually elevated into some enormous moral code. It's more in the question of custom or habit. And that, I think, is the natural state of human morality, and it's closer to the kind of implicit behavioral norms that we find in animal societies. Bees, wasps, ants, flocks of birds, all of them have ways of cooperating together. That means that the individual members of the society work together, usually fairly harmoniously, in a way that's mutually beneficial. And this we find in human societies. We're social animals, and as such, we find that our societies are influenced by social bonds and social norms, like any other social animal. We make it conscious and we elevate it into the name of morality, but the word morality is quite a recent invention. I mean, in traditional human societies, the word morality isn't exactly used in our modern sense. There are certain norms of behavior. You don't do certain kinds of things and you can do other kinds of things. And if you do things that are prohibited, you're ultimately expelled from the society in one way or another. But I think this abstract notion of morality is not very helpful. That's my own feeling. The purpose of an individual in a traditional society is to live in accordance with the myths of the way the ancestors have lived. Innovation is not particularly relevant. In fact, it's a way of deviating from an established path that's been followed many times before. It's dangerous. Whereas our society has put a great emphasis on innovation and has correspondingly weakened the sense of following ancestral paths and customs, and therefore gives the sense that each new generation is somehow better, wiser, cleverer than the last. So our societies are full of problems of adolescent rebellion. You don't get this in traditional societies, because each generation now has to prove itself better, cleverer, more advanced than the last. And so this lack of rooting in tradition creates conditions where innovation can happen more readily, and that in turn weakens the influence of the past. And so our societies are evolving with a dissolution of the old social structures, hurtling into the future in a way that nobody can foresee where it's leading. The dissolution of traditional morality and traditional social and family patterns is something that's happening far faster than I think anyone imagined in the past, and will leave us with a kind of society that no one can really envisage in the future. I mean, if families fragment, if more and more children grow up outside the normal socializing influence of the family. Now in Britain, 25% of children are now being raised by single parents, mostly single mothers. In Northern England, over 50% of children are now being born to parents who are not married, to mothers who are not married. And so the traditional family system is breaking down, and nobody has any idea, it's never happened before, what happens to society if the principal socializing influences on children are no longer present. And yet this is a logical outcome of the dissolution of all traditional forms of social order. And I don't think it's leading anywhere that most people would welcome or look forward to.
What do you expect?
Well, I don't know. I think that it's very hard to envisage how a society can be changed when many people within it lack the basic elements of socialization, of being brought within social forms, constraints, and customs. And I think this is the problem of inner cities in the United States, where there's now large areas which are full of what they talk of as a kind of unmanageable underclass that may not be possible to incorporate within the kind of consensus pattern of liberal democracy depends on individuals being strongly motivated morally through traditions. But if those traditions that sustain the individuals dissolve, the state, the liberal state itself, tries to be neutral. It's based on the model of science. It's based on a kind of scientific norm. The state is a technocratic structure to bring about services in a morally neutral manner, following the idea that in science you can separate values and facts. And so promoting the idea of tolerance of different social groups, but the state can itself give no cultural norms to people within it. And therefore, liberal states live on the capital of the past in terms of the religious teachings of the Jewish and the Christian and other religious traditions. As those break down, then there's nothing to take their place. And it's very doubtful that this kind of society can survive for very long, in my opinion. I think if we just have an extrapolation of present trends, dissolution of the social order, rising population in the third world, exhaustion of resources, pollution of the planet, destruction of long-term reserves of everything in terms of short-term consumption, then we'll see a collapse, at least, of our civilization and the present political and social order, massive famine, appalling disasters, a kind of apocalyptic scenario of destruction. And it may not be uniformly spread. I mean, there may be places in the world where you hardly know it's going on. Just read about it in the newspapers. Mm-hmm. As it is indeed at present, there are terrible things happening in Africa with famines and civil wars, but they hardly touch us. So it may be that things will start falling apart in Africa and in other parts of the world. Well, people in Western Europe may go on quite comfortably for a bit longer, but I don't think we can be insulated forever from these things. And so I think the present order is doomed, but what will take its place is not at all clear to me. Whether the present kind of system, the present kind of state, has the ability to reform itself.
Or is delivered to chaos.
Well, chaos doesn't usually last long. I mean, people don't like chaos. Like in Russia, they don't like chaos, and they've got chaos now. So it's only a matter of time before you have kind of neo-fascist dictatorships springing up, I suppose.
In one of your books, you had a quotation from Jacques Monod.
Mm-hmm.
I'll read it. Man must at last wake out of his millenary dream and discover his total solitude, his fundamental isolation. He must realize that, like a gypsy, he lives on the boundaries of an alien world, a world that is deaf to his music and as indifferent to his hopes as it is to his sufferings and his crimes. Why did you quote him?
Well, because Monod represents very clearly and puts very explicitly the natural outcome of a kind of mechanistic, materialistic view of nature and of humanity. This is the natural outcome. Most people don't think it through to its logical conclusion, but if you do, this is the logical conclusion. This is the development of the movement started by Galileo and Descartes, which has now worked itself out in our society and indeed has been exported to the rest of the world as a view of reality. Those are its consequences. And Monod just makes them very clear and very explicit. I quoted it because he does so with such clarity.
Als je zegt herinneringen, waarover praat je dan? Uit welke herinneringen zijn we opgebouwd? Welke verhalen kenden we al nog voordat we uit de baarmoeder kwamen? Of, om met Sheldrake te spreken, ver voordat we zelfs maar werden verwekt? Die vraag ligt aan de basis van heel zijn theorie. Ik vraag hem om te beginnen waar onze herinneringen zijn opgeslagen.
Well, I think that where's the wrong question. Memory is a phenomenon of relation in time. And when we see that memory is principally to do with the interrelation of events in time. It's not immediately obvious that the question where plays much part in this. You see, where is memory stored immediately traps us in a whole set of spatial metaphors, and the problem is that we think of time in terms of spatial metaphors, the near future, the distant past. And so people think, well, there must be a memory store. So where is the memory store? Is it in the brain? Is it in the Akashic records, as the Theosophists would say, in some kind of ethereal realm beyond the normal realm? But all of these are ways of trying to find a place for memory. Well, I don't think it is in a place. I think it's a relation in time. I don't think it's stored in the brain, you see. I think we tune into our memories, that we directly tune into them, involving a kind of transmission in time. This is a key part of my particular theory of morphic resonance. So memories are not exactly in places. I think that the past is potentially present everywhere, and that through similarity or whatever, we then tune into or access aspects of past experience. But it's not, in the meantime, stored anywhere in particular.
Penfield did some experiments. You wrote about it. What did his experiments prove?
Penfield did some experiments where he stimulated the lobes, the temporal lobes of the brain of epileptic patients. And he found that when he stimulated them electrically in certain places, they had vivid flashes of memory. Now, we don't know they were actual memories. They may have been hallucinations, but they seemed like memories, and he assumed they really were. Let's assume they were. His first conclusion was that this proves the memories are stored in the part of the brain he'd stimulated, which he called the memory cortex. In his last book, called The Mystery of the Mind, Penfield discarded his own earlier interpretation. He gave up the idea that memories were stored in the temporal lobes, or indeed anywhere else in the brain in particular places, and came round to the view that memories were curiously diffuse, that you couldn't localize them in particular places. In fact, in his last book, Penfield became a dualist, a kind of Cartesian dualist, so he saw the mind interacting with the brain, and he no longer felt the need to have a brain location for every kind of mental function. So my own view, you see, would be that the brain is more like a TV receiver than a video recorder, that you tune in to yourself in the past as a kind of transmission through time by what I call morphic resonance from the past to the present.
Before entering morphic resonance and your hypothesis of formative causation, just remembering, Freud stated, where is it? Prehistoric times have found their psychic repercussions in the heritage that in each generation only needs to be revived, not acquired. Children, in many ways, do not react according to their own experiences, but according to instinct comparable to animals, in a way that can only be explained by assuming that they have phylogenetic knowledge at their disposal. When I talk with Oliver Sacks, and he also writes about this, he is talking about pre-human memories that go back to the darkest corners of existence, and that providing his patients with images from the prehistoric and pre-human landscape. How familiar does that sound to you, this phylogenetic memory, the pre-human landscape we are living in, and although we are living now?
Well, it sounds entirely familiar to me. I think that we inherit a great deal of collective memory from our ancestors, and you know, I think it goes back a long, long way. Some kinds of things go back further than others, but, for example, the experience of a child on its mother's breast, a very fundamental experience very early in life, is in resonance with the experience of young mammals sucking from breasts, you know, for 60, maybe 100 million years of mammalian history, that there's not much difference between a human baby sucking at a breast and a piglet sucking at a breast, or any other mammal sucking at a breast. And this has been the defining characteristic of mammals ever since the mammals first evolved. So there's something in this which many of us have had, or those who haven't have sucked at bottles which are breath substitutes, that involves utterly fundamental experience, which is so similar to that of phylogenetic memory going back many, many millions of years, that I think it would almost inevitably invoke or be related to this long, long series of memories.
But Sex is talking about pre-human landscapes.
Well, so am I. The mammals are pre-human. They go back 60...
Even pre-mammal landscapes, and even pre-dinosaur landscape. You understand what I mean?
Well, yes. I'm not quite sure what kind of experience he might be referring to. I think that for many people, I mean, psychedelic visions, for example, people who take psychedelics and see astonishing visionary states, often describe things that could be regarded as pre-human. The psychologist Stan Grof, who's studied the effects of LSD on many, many people, has collected the stories they've told, and he's been driven to the conclusion that this is a particularly effective way of evoking a kind of pre-human memories, which normally would be suppressed. Most of us would spend a lot of time suppressing these archaic memories. They wouldn't come out in ordinary everyday life. They might come out in dreams, but we might then forget them. But in certain unusual and altered states of consciousness, they may become clearer. But the vast majority of that memory is unconscious, just as the great majority of our own memory is unconscious. Most of us can't remember how we developed inside our mother's womb. Most of us can't remember almost anything that happened in the first few years of our lives. And if we can't remember even our own ordinary personal history, we're not likely to have very vivid memories of life as a trilobite many millions of years ago, or as a cell in the primeval slime. So I think that the kind of memory that's implicit through this evolutionary history is essentially a memory of unconscious habits. And you could say that the cells in our bodies participate in the unconscious habits of cells right back to the first cell, including the way that cells divide and many features of cellular organization and behavior. But that these memories are not expressed as conscious reminiscences in any sense. They're more like the kinds of memories expressed through our own habits. Like when you ride a bicycle, you can't really talk about it. You can't say why you do it, but it's certainly a memory. You have to learn it. You get on the bicycle, you can just do it. So that's a kind of memory, but it's not a kind of conscious reflection at all. And so I would say the kind of memory we inherit from our forebears and way back from pre-human ancestors is much more of that general kind, to do with habits. In the behavioral realm, these are expressed in animals as instincts, which are quite unconscious patterns of behaving.
I'll quote you very short. I show how the hypothesis of formative causation points towards a new and radically evolutionary understanding of ourselves and the world we live in. We're there. This is something, and it's quite a promise. Could you try to convince everybody who's looking? What is formative causation? What are you heading for if you say that it points towards a new and radically evolutionary understanding of ourselves and the world we live in? We leave memory behind, it will return, but what is it?
Well, I have to start with a historical description. In terms of evolution, we've recognized since the time of Darwin that there's a general evolution in the biological realm. Before Darwin, it was generally accepted there was an evolution in the human realm. There'd been an evolution of human consciousness. Hegel talked about this at the beginning of the 19th century. And in the 18th century, the progressive philosophers, the rationalists, and so on, were obsessed with the idea of human progress, the idea of a progress of society from barbarism to civilization and then to science and so on. And it's a familiar story of human evolution. But they didn't think then that evolution occurred in the biological realm. Then Darwin showed you could have a scientific theory of biological evolution. So now human evolution was embedded in a much bigger evolutionary story, the evolution of life. But the physicists, resisted the idea that physics or chemistry evolved. They were locked into a view of the universe as eternal, a great machine that went on forever, but gradually running down, running out of steam, running down thermodynamically. So they had a great machine that was gradually devolving, governed by eternal laws of nature that never changed, and by particles of matter and a quantity of motion that never changed, forever conserved. The same.
Life evolves, but the laws of physics do not.
That's right. Physics itself doesn't evolve, and according to that view, the basic principles of physics are totally non-evolutionary. So that was the idea until the 1960s. Then the Big Bang Revolution occurred in cosmology, and we now have a view that the whole cosmos evolves. The whole of physics and chemistry has evolved, that at one time even the fields of nature, the electromagnetic gravitational field, were not separate and distinct in the way they are now. They were part of a primal field, according to superstring theory. And then in the chemical realm, once there were no atoms, and certainly at one time there were no zinc atoms or iron atoms or aluminium atoms, these have all evolved historically in time as the cosmos has developed. And then molecules and crystals, once there were none of them, now there are many kinds. So the whole of physics and chemistry has also undergone an evolutionary development. So we now have a radically evolutionary cosmology, but a relic of the old thinking is still there, in that most people think that the universe is governed by eternal laws of nature. The laws don't evolve. Now, what I'm suggesting is that the so-called laws of nature are not fixed. If we live in a radically evolutionary cosmos, which since the 1960s, it's been recognized, and even in physics, that this is the case, then why shouldn't the laws of evolution evolve, the laws of nature evolve as well? And my view is that they're not really so much laws as more like habits, that what happens in nature depends on what's happened before. There's a kind of memory in nature, rather than a kind of eternal mathematical mind sustaining eternal laws.
It's not mechanistic, it's living.
Well, first of all,
paraphrase.
Yes, I would say that the universe is not a machine, it's more like an organism. And the Big Bang Theory is like the traditional myths of the cracking of the cosmic egg. It tells us the universe began small, that ever since that beginning it's been growing, and as it's grown, new structures and patterns have developed within it. This is like an embryo. No machine starts small and grows and forms new structures, but a tree does as it grows from a seed, or an embryo does as it grows from a fertilized egg. And so, effectively, our modern cosmology has given us a view of the whole universe as a developing organism. Everything is developing and evolving. So, I would argue the old idea of eternal laws, which fitted so well with an eternal universe, the universe physicists liked to believe in, and spent 100 years after Darwin, they resisted the evolutionary idea tooth and nail, because it's so alien to the traditions of physics, which is radically non-evolutionary. But now they've finally gone over to an evolutionary view of the world. But still, there's this residue of the old thinking, the idea of eternal laws, and that's what I'm questioning, that's what I'm challenging. And so I'm arguing that the idea of formative causation gives us a sense of memory in nature, in all kinds of nature, in all aspects of nature. So we can think of the evolution of nature being accompanied by the evolution of the habits of nature, rather than the whole thing being governed by fixed laws that were all there at the moment of the Big Bang. So when I say this hypothesis gives us a radically evolutionary understanding of ourselves and the universe, what I'm doing is trying to extend the evolutionary model to its limit. Because, you see, what we've seen is a series of extensions. First it was confined to the human realm, then to the biological realm, now to the realm of physical phenomena. But still, the idea that the laws of nature are eternal is the last residue of this old paradigm, this old way of thinking. And I think that's the next frontier that we have to extend the evolutionary model to.
But formative causation, what does it really mean? What is a morphogenetic field, or what is morphic resonance? What do you mean by that?
Well, the question is the question of form, order, pattern, structure. That's the question I'm dealing with. And you see, science has been quite good at telling us what things are made out of. It's rather like trying to understand a city like Amsterdam by going and analysing the bricks. Say they're made of a particular kind of mud and, or clay and it has a particular composition. It will tell you something about the weathering of the buildings, the nature of the city, the potentialities of building in that material. But it won't tell you anything about the architecture or the layout of the streets. And so there's a formative, it's like the architectural principle as opposed to the building materials. This is the aspect of nature which has been largely ignored by science. It spent a lot of time breaking things down and analysing what they're made out of. And of course, everything's made out of something or other. At least every body is made out of bits and materials. And so you can always find answers that way. But when you break things down to look at the bits, you lose the form, the structure. If you knock a house down to analyse the materials it's made of, then you've lost the form, the plan, the structure of the house in this very act of analysis. And in nature, the question, especially in biology, of form, of pattern, of structure, and it's also in chemistry, because chemistry is a science of forms. Molecules have particular forms, and so do atoms, and so do crystals. All these forms require an understanding of the formative principles that give rise to them. And that's what I'm talking about in formative causation. I think that formative causation is the kind of causation responsible for form, structure, or pattern. And I think that the causal influence on this is what I call the morphogenetic field, or more shortly, the morphic field, from the Greek word morphe, meaning form. So I think each kind of thing has a field which gives it its form, pattern, structure, or order, and that this field, which is like the plan or the shaping influence on it, has the form it does because of a kind of memory. There's a kind of memory inherent in this field. So if we take an animal like a giraffe and we consider how it grows or develops, then we would say it's shaped as it grows as an embryo and as it grows up after birth by the fields of its species, the morphogenetic fields of its species. But then how do those fields get the form they do? I would say they get them from previous giraffes by the process I call morphic resonance, an influence of similar things on subsequent similar things. So the fields that organize things have a kind of inherent memory within them.
They're non-material?
They're non-material, but they're physical. To explain that, I have to say...
Like gravity is physical.
Yes.
And non-existent itself.
Yes, the gravitational field is physical. It has physical effects. It's part of nature. Phusis, in Aristotle's word, was nature, the Greek word nature is the basis of our word physical. It's part of nature, the gravitational field. But it's not material in the sense that it's made of matter. You see, when Newton first thought of gravitational force, the question arose, well, what's it made of? How does the moon affect the tides on the Earth? What's in between? And some people said, well, if it's something that happens, it must be made of matter. So there must be subtle matter, the ether. They invented a special kind of subtle matter to be the basis of the field. But what Einstein showed was that we don't need the ether as the basis of electromagnetic or gravitational fields. They're themselves made of space or space-time. Fields are patterns in space or space-time. And matter is made of fields and energy rather than fields being made of matter.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say the morphogenetic fields and morphic fields in general are physical. They're part of nature. They have physical effects. But they're not made of matter any more than gravitational fields are made of matter.
Can you give some examples of what, for instance, the fruit flies or the blue tits or the rats or the nursery rhymes or the puzzles or whatever experiments have been done? Can you give some experiments that have been done to prove the hypothesis of informative causation, and first describe them.
Well, the theory makes a lot of predictions. It's every kind of thing, even crystals, have a kind of memory of previous similar ones. So take the example of rats learning new tricks. This is the easiest example to understand. The animals within a given species draw on a collective memory and in turn contribute to it through morphic resonance. So if you train rats to learn a new trick in London, then what I'm saying is that rats in Holland, in Germany, in America, in Australia, in Russia, all around the world, rats should learn this same trick more quickly just because the rats have learned it here. And this should happen just because they're rats learning the same thing. It doesn't depend on telephoning people and telling them how to do it, or taking rats to teach the other ones, or letting the rats squeak over the telephone to rats somewhere else. It should happen anyway, and the more rats that learn it here, the easier it should get everywhere else. So that's the basic prediction in the realm of animal behavior.
And prediction?
That's a prediction. And then, in terms of what happens, first of all, there's quite a lot of circumstantial evidence from studies of rats and other animals that as people have studied them in laboratories over the years, they've shown quite dramatic improvements in learning rates in standard laboratory tasks. And these improvements have been found all over the world in a way that's both puzzling and mysterious. And because there's no theory in science that could explain this until morphic resonance came along, these results have simply been ignored. They're lying around in the archives of science. So one of the things I've done is dusted off a whole lot of existing experimental data which provide quite good circumstantial evidence for morphic resonance.
What about the blue tits? It's one
well,
of
the blue tits is another example, and the blue tit example is one of the few cases we have of a new pattern of animal behavior spreading and the rate of its spread being carefully monitored. Normally, people don't study these things in any detail. In this case, thanks to the efforts of hundreds of amateur bird watchers all over Europe, this was studied. What happened was that blue tits, these little blue birds, blue-headed birds, discovered in about 1920 that when milk was delivered to doorsteps in England, that they could tear the top off the milk bottle and drink the cream. And when this had first been discovered, about 20 years after milk deliveries began in England, nothing happened for 20 years. Then a blue tit in Southampton in southern England discovered this, and it spread locally, and the other blue tits copied, until lots of them were doing it. And then the habit turned up somewhere else, far away, far further than blue tits could have flown, because they don't usually move very far from their home.
So they couldn't have told each other?
They couldn't have told each other. It was discovered independently in another city, and then somewhere else. And the rate of independent discovery, which was carefully documented, accelerated. More and more of them were learning to do it, until by the late 30s or 40s, this was happening practically everywhere in Britain. And the rate of discovery accelerated in such a striking way that the professor of zoology at Oxford, Sir Alistair Hardy, came to the conclusion that something like telepathy might be involved. It seemed mysterious to many people at the time. But the most interesting results are the Dutch ones, because once British blue tits had started doing this, then continental ones started in Holland, in Sweden, in Denmark, and other countries. And the habit spread in Holland as it did in Britain, similar pattern. But the difference is that in Holland, when the Germans invaded, the delivery of milk bottles stopped. So there was no more milk for the blue tits to steal. Didn't begin again till 1948. Blue tits don't live more than about 3 years. So after 8 or 9 years, there were no blue tits left that could remember the golden age of free cream before the war. And yet, when milk deliveries began again in the Netherlands, then within 2 or 3 years, all over Holland, blue tits were stealing milk.
What about the humans? What kind of experiments have been done? And to what extent do they prove your hypothesis of formative causation? Can you give me some examples?
Yes. Well, first, I should say that this hypothesis applies to human learning as well as rat learning. Obviously, it's a general principle. And so it means that it should be getting easier, for example, for children to learn to program computers just because many have learned to do it, or to play video games because many have learned them already, or to solve the Rubik Cube. These predictions in the human realm are supported by a certain amount of, well, a lot of circumstantial evidence, but we need to control for all the other variables. So you have to do quite specific experiments. And a lot of experiments have been done now on morphic resonance in human psychology. 2 or 3 have given inconclusive results where the But the great majority, something like 90% of the experiments that have been done, have shown quite clear effects in the direction of morphic resonance. To give a few examples, the easiest to understand, although not the best experiment, is one that was done with crossword puzzles here in England 2 years ago. This was done at Nottingham University, and the person who did it, a young woman called Monica England, reasoned as follows. If morphic resonance is happening, it should be easier to solve today's crossword puzzle tomorrow than it would have been yesterday, because so many people have done it today. Now, hundreds of thousands of people do newspaper crosswords. So to do this experiment, all you need is to persuade a newspaper to supply their crossword in advance, so you can test people before it's published and after. And we persuaded the London Evening Standard newspaper to supply their crossword in advance for this experiment. And the day before it was published in London, students in Nottingham were tested with this crossword and with a control crossword that was not published during this period. 10 minutes on each crossword to solve as many of the clues as they could. And then you mark it to see how many they've got right, and that gives you a score. And then other students were tested after it had been published in London. And this newspaper is not circulated in Nottingham, so none of them would have done the crossword. And it turned out that the score on the test crossword increased quite substantially by about 20%, whereas the control crossword didn't change at all. This shows that the test crossword became easier to do after people had done it in London. Now, the control was controlling for individual variations in crossword solving skills. That didn't change, you see. You look at the test results relative to the control. Anyway, this experiment is something which I've subsequently found from people who do crosswords habitually is quite a well-known fact. A lot of people have written to me saying that they do the Times crossword puzzle, which is a very difficult one in England, regularly. And they've often found that they do better if they do it in the evening of the day that it's published, or even the next day, rather than if they do it straight away in the morning.
Because?
Because so many people have already solved it. Well, the people who have found this by experience have no explanation. They just have found this by experience. And when the results of this crossword experiment were published, then suddenly they found an explanation for something they'd discovered by themselves.
Wie zit er nou eigenlijk tegenover me? De nieuwe Darwin en Einstein in één persoon, zoals veel mensen menen. Of iemand die, zoals veel van zijn komende tafelgenoten oordelen, een geniale theorie heeft ontworpen die hopeloos fout is. Wat je ook over de theorie mag denken, de experimenten lijken onthutsend. Mensen die het oude Morse-alfabet veel sneller blijken te leren dan het nieuwe Morse-alfabet, dat toch veel logischer en eenvoudiger in elkaar zit. Kinderversjes uit Japan.
I've done some experiments with Japanese nursery rhymes. The reasoning there was that if you take a nursery rhyme that's been known to millions of children over the centuries, and they've all learned it to sing it, it should be easier for English or American people or Dutch people or German people to learn that nursery rhyme than some other rhyme, similar rhyme. Now, the problem with this experiment, it's a problem that can't easily be surmounted, is to find another rhyme that's equally intrinsically easy or difficult. To do this, I had the help of a Japanese poet, Shuntaro Tanikawa, who's one of the leading poets in Japan, who wrote some other rhymes with a similar rhythm and word pattern to a common Japanese nursery rhyme. And I then got groups of people and individuals to memorize. He gave two false rhymes and there was one real rhyme. I didn't know which was the real one myself. And got groups of people to memorize these rhymes by chanting them in the way that children do. And then later they were tested to see how much they could remember of each of the rhymes.
And?
And, sure enough, they remembered, they were able to remember more of the genuine nursery rhyme than of the other two.
Much more, or?
Oh, yes. They remembered it about twice as well as the others. It was quite a big effect. So this is the kind of effect one would expect. This, however, was one of the first experiments I did, and one of the problems with it is that you can never be sure that the new rhyme is equally difficult to the old one. So it's not as convincing an experiment as it could be. Nevertheless, I would have been worried if it hadn't worked.
Yes. You wrote, when people learn something new, such as windsurfing, then as more people learn to do it, it should tend to become progressively easier to learn just because so many other people have learned to do it already. That is windsurfing. When I'm talking about the Industrial Revolution, for instance, it occurs in the Western Hemisphere, yes, for 2 centuries. Why did it not show up? Or why was it not imitated? At the same time, in, for instance, Africa, India, Indonesia, South Latin America. Is this a stupid question from us?
No, it's not a stupid question, but the question is, the general question is one of parallel inventions and discoveries. There are many examples of cultural patterns that have evolved independently in different parts of the world, and archaeologists are often very puzzled by them. Mm-hmm. And in fact, that's why you get theories of people floating around the world on little rafts carrying cultures with them. Well, in a world with morphic resonance, there's no need to have all these hypothetical rafts floating around the world, because people could pick it up anyway. Now, you see, the key feature of morphic resonance is similarity. If people are confronting a similar problem that other people have already solved somewhere else, they'll be more likely to find the same solution. But if they're not confronting that problem, then they won't come up with a solution. They won't resonate with the other people. So if you have 2 lots of people trying to solve the same kind of scientific or mathematical or technological or economic problem, you'd have ideal conditions for morphic resonance, and one of them may pick up what the others have, a solution the others have found. But if you have a tribe of people in Africa pursuing hunting or gathering, like pygmies in the Congo rainforest, and you have entrepreneurs in Victorian Manchester in England trying to find ways of spinning cloth more cheaply using industrial looms, there's such a difference between the problems that they're confronting that you wouldn't expect any resonance in that situation, that any more than you'd expect the pygmies to start speaking English.
But at the moment, a culture is faced with, for instance, aspects of Industrial Revolution, really faced. We bring it there, they can see it, they can experience what is happening. At that moment, I should think, they will take over, if you follow the hypothesis of formative causation.
Well, as soon as you... I don't agree. I think that as soon as people are confronted with the kind of industrial mentality and the industrial artifacts and start thinking in that kind of way. I mean, the remarkable thing is that the Industrial Revolution has spread to all parts of the world. I mean, you've got factories all over Africa, South America. The remarkable thing is that precisely this way of doing things has spread phenomenally fast. As soon as the links of trade and exports of industrial goods and techniques of capital and investment and so on, now, part of this is, of course, ordinary communication. I would never claim this as an example for morphic resonance, because a lot of it depends on perfectly normal means of human communication. But I would say that the remarkable thing is that as soon as these things are introduced to other cultures and people are introduced to these ways of doing things, they get it so fast. Mm-hmm. In New Guinea, for example, there are New Guineans driving lorries and operating machines when their fathers were living in a Stone Age culture. In a single generation, people have jumped about 20,000 years of human history. And that's what's so remarkable about the whole process of world development, that these things do spread so fast.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think it's a disaster myself in many ways, but the fact is that there's an enormously fast spread, however you choose to explain it.
I'm wondering, because it's one of the problems concerning morphogenetic fields. Little question, how big are morphogenetic fields? Light years, are they reaching the ends of the universe?
Every organism that's organized by a field, a crystal, a cell, a giraffe, a cow, a person, is organized by a field within and around it. So just like a magnetic field is within and around the magnet, so the morphic field of an organism is within and around the organism. It's quite local. Now, what is non-local, what involves moving over great distances, is morphic resonance. Morphic resonance is the influence of one organism on another through or across space and time. And this resonance is, I think, independent of distance in the sense that it doesn't fall off with distance in space or time. Now, if that's the case, then people learning something in one part of the world should influence people all around the world, as long as they're in similar conditions, without showing any diminution due to distance. And more generally, if this is the case, it means that events on one planet or in one star could influence those in other stars or planets, even in other galaxies. There could be morphic resonance effects working over huge distances in the universe.
Yes, you wrote, there is the possibility that most, if not all, new patterns of activity that appear on Earth have already appeared frequently elsewhere in the universe or previous universes. Morphic resonance from these systems may swamp the predicted effects elsewhere in the universe or previous universes. I told my children tales like this. For you, it's simply a possibility.
It's a possibility.
Not Arabian Nights.
No, I think it's a possibility. I mean, it's a possibility that I don't think everything that's happened here has happened everywhere else. And the reason I think that is for the empirical fact that apparent morphic resonance effects do seem to be detectable. You see, if morphic resonance effects are not detectable, if there's no improvement with time, there are theoretically three other possibilities. One is that morphic resonance is wrong as a theory, which I'm sure most people would think, probably I would too, if the experiments didn't work. The second is that morphic resonance that everything that happens here has happened on other worlds somewhere else so often that there's nothing truly new happening on Earth. So you wouldn't see these effects because everything would already be governed by established habits.
Mm-hmm.
The third possibility is that morphic resonance works from the future as well as the past, in which case everything that's going to happen will also influence what's happening now. And since we don't know what's going to happen, this makes the theory virtually untestable. But it's a theoretical possibility. So what I'm concerned with here is the way that the novelty of things on Earth. If morphic resonance experiments yield positive results, in other words, if things get easier and easier, if we can see habits building up in nature, then either this shows that morphic resonance doesn't work over astronomical distances, or it shows that what's happening on Earth, these events that we're studying, are truly original in the cosmos. And so, therefore, this opens up a theoretical possibility, an institute of cosmic novelty that could be set up on quite a low budget, where you could find out what's happened over the whole of the rest of the cosmos by testing for morphic resonance with the crystallization of thousands of different chemicals, for example. Now, if some of these chemicals turn out not to show a morphic resonance effect, if the crystals form the same way at the beginning and go on forming the same way, showing no habit, no tendency to crystallize better or faster, then we can infer these compounds have existed in a crystalline form elsewhere in the universe. If we find ones that do show this learning experience, that show this build-up of habit, we can infer that these have occurred for the first time here on Earth. So we can actually map what's happened elsewhere in the universe on a low-budget terrestrial laboratory without any need for expensive space probes, space shuttles, or other space technology costing many billions.
Wie zou ooit geloven dat beelden, geluid en muziek door de lege ruimte kunnen worden verstuurd over duizelingwekkende afstanden als televisie, radio en telefoon niet waren uitgevonden? Wie zou kunnen geloven dat een hersenloos ding met plastic wanden berekeningen zou kunnen doorvoeren in fracties van seconden waar een normaal mens weken over zou doen, als niet ooit de computer was uitgevonden? Neem, om de gedachte te bepalen, iemand uit de 14e eeuw. Had hem verteld dat hij in de toekomst naar een wijk in Londen kon kijken, waar een bepaalde meneer Sheldrake woont. Terwijl hij helemaal niet in Londen zou zijn en hij bovendien zou kijken naar de wijk zoals die er een paar maanden eerder bij lag. Dat hij de tijd dus, als het ware, kon bewaren in een blikken doosje op een smal rolletje. Dat is de voorlopige achterstand van Sheldrake en zijn theorie. Zolang zijn ideeën niet vertaald worden in praktische toepassingen, blijft het wetenschappelijke ketterij rijp voor de brandstapel.
What changes things fast is if you find a way in which a scientific discovery can be applied. If it then becomes a matter of business, commerce, everyday activity, then it doesn't matter about the theory. My primary aim is not applications of morphic resonance. I'm simply saying that when it reaches the point where it's applied, which may not be very far off, then it will take on a kind of reality in our present cultural context that it won't have until there are actual applications.
What kind of applications do you think of as far as formative causation is concerned? What could be a technological application?
Well, there are several.
So that people suddenly are convinced, well, of course, Sheldrake is right.
Well, two possibilities. The first would be an educational application. If morphic resonance is involved in learning, then we may be able to find ways of enhancing morphic resonance so that we can greatly increase the efficiency of learning or training procedures. Already, some of the experiments on morphic resonance have shown that people learning tasks on computers can learn them quicker after other people have learned the same thing. And if we can improve the conditions for learning or training, this would be something that could be applied within a few years, at least within commerce, probably not within schools and universities. They'd be the last. But within commerce and industry, people are not interested in theories. They're interested in what works. Another area would be there's a possibility, it's a technical thing, that it's on the borderline of what's possible, but it's possible that there's that morphic resonance is at work in certain laser, the pathways lasers make when going through certain kinds of crystals. If this is the case, then it might be possible to develop a new kind of memory-based morphic resonance technology, which would fit into modern optical computers. The new generation of computers will be optical. And if one had a computer that worked on morphic resonance, paradoxically, one might come far closer to something that Dennett and people dream of, namely an organic machine which would be capable of thought, memory, and indeed communication with other similar machines, because they'd resonate with each other around the world. No need for telephone lines, satellites, or normal means of transmission. It's possible, paradoxically, that morphic resonance could give the very kind of technology, of a kind of organic technology that Dennett and many others dream of. But in doing so, it would mean that we have to accept a basically organic way of thinking about the whole of nature. The old kind of machine metaphors would have to go or be superseded. Now, that kind of application, which I'm discussing at the present with one of the leading Japanese electronic companies who are actually now doing research on this, could come true. And I don't know, I mean, it may not. It's an outside chance. Well, they and I both think it's an outside chance, you know, 1 in 10, 1 in 100, I don't know. But if this happened, the world would be changed quite fast.
Een wat rommelig afscheid, hoewel zeer gentlemanlike. Uren en uren nadat we begonnen bij Sheldrake's ontdekking op de wilgenboerderij van zijn grootouders. Uren nadat we het hadden over de fascinaties van zijn eigen kinderen. Bijvoorbeeld hun fascinatie voor de dood.
He says what happens when you die. You see, and so part of it is that of course your body decays. He likes playing in the local, when we go to the church on Sundays, he likes playing in the graveyard of Hampstead Parish Church. There are old tombs and they're all overgrown with ivy and there are yew trees and so on. It's a very old and romantic and beautiful graveyard. So he loves hiding behind these tombs, and he's very interested in whether they've all got skeletons in them, which they have. And so he knows that bodies decay, that you bury them in graveyards and the body decays. So the question is, do you have any sense of life? So my best explanation to him is that it's like dreaming, since I believe there is some kind of conscious survival of death. The best way I can conceive of it is that our life is, as I said at the beginning, rounded with a dream, in the sense that we, when we die, it may be rather like dreaming. And if you have a very bad dream, a kind of nightmare, then that may be rather like hell. You can't wake up. The point is that after you're dead, you can't wake up anymore. So you're like trapped in dreams permanently. And when we dream normally, of course our physical body is lying in bed. But when we dream, we have the sensation of going to other places, talking to other people, seeing things, walking around, even flying. Now, none of these things that we're actually doing in our physical body. So we all have every night, even if we don't remember it, the experience of living in another kind of body, doing other kinds of things which our physical body is not doing. So we're familiar through years and years of dreaming, most of which we forget, most of which is comes from our unconscious in ways that we're not aware of. Most of us don't pay much attention to dreams, yet we all have a dream life, which is a kind of parallel life to our ordinary life, not in our ordinary body, but in what we could call our dream body, because we have an implicit body in our dreams, even if we're not aware of it. And this dream body then comes back into our physical body, and when we wake up, there we are. We've woken up, we forget about the dream.
But at the moment we are dying?
Well, at the moment we're dying, maybe the one way of thinking about the way we survive bodily death would be in a kind of dream body. Because, now, I leave aside the obvious question of what's the physical basis of the dream body. I'm just now talking
brains.
About what we experience. Well, I mean, we can leave the brain out of it for the time being. I'm just talking about our actual experience. Yes. Our actual experience is of having another body in our dreams and of travelling to other places and seeing other things. And most people in most cultures for most of human history have believed that in our dreams we do, in some sense, travel outside our body. And sorcerers and shamans and witches have perfected the techniques of travelling consciously in dreams, in so-called lucid dreams. There's the ability, when you know you're dreaming, you can take control of the dream and use it to go and visit people in distant places, see what they're doing. And there are reports that people can really find out things they didn't otherwise know through this kind of dream travel. Anyway, this is something we find in all shamanic traditions and in all psychic traditions. So, just sticking to the evidence as we experience it, leaving out of it theories about the brain, we could then see that when we die there's this sense of continuation in the dream state. And you can then see there could be different kinds of dreams, and we all have our own kinds of dreams depending on who we are, what our personality is like, what our interests and desires are. So the post-mortal dream state that we're in would very much depend on the kinds of people we are and the kinds of memories and experience we've had. And I think that the traditional doctrines of life after death fit quite well with the kind of dream state. The nightmare would be like hell. Ordinary dreams, which are neither completely good nor completely bad, would be like the Catholic idea of purgatory, where there's a continued development. You continue after death to have some kind of psychic life, but it's not the psychic life of the ordinary waking state. I think it may be more like the psychic life of the dream state. And then there may be within that the possibility of sometimes there are totally blissful dreams when there's a kind of liberation from the ordinary limitations of dreaming, and that may be the kind of final liberation from that intermediate state, a kind of mystical experience within the dream, which is possible, which some people have. I've had some myself. So anyway, this is the analogy, this is my starting point, and you asked me how I talk about it to my four-year-old son, and that's the answer, that's how I talk about it. Now, if I were talking about it to somebody like Daniel Dennett, I'd obviously have to be talking about it in a completely different way, because he'd immediately bring in the brain and his theories about the brain and so on, which would be a different kind of discussion.
Yeah, there's an illusion with that, an illusionist, like he calls a dream.
Yes, they call it an illusion.
Caused well, by this army of dumb idiots forming our brain experiences.
Exactly. Well, I would say, well, that's just as much a theory as the other one, you see, that these are different theories. But one can start with experience. We all have experience of dreams.
We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little lives are rounded with a sleep.
Rounded with a sleep. I mean, the idea that our life is like a dream. I suppose so, yes. I mean, actually, I think it's the other way around. I think that when we die, or before we're born, it's probably more like a dream, and that it's as if our lives are rounded with a dream. And of course, dreams are part of sleep, so that still fits with what Shakespeare says.